Hello, everybody. Welcome back. It is Monday, June 10th, 2024, and you are listening to episode 189 of Midnight Film Society. I'm your host, Damian Sherman. Joining me, as always, today is
Derek McDuff.
On today's show, with a lighter week of must-see blockbusters, we get into some movie and TV news before diving straight into what we've been watching, including In a Violent Nature, Hacks, Young Woman and the Sea, and much, much more. But before that, we'll check in with my Best Picture Marathon progress and see how our movie swap challenge is going. Right into the show, midnightfilmsociety@gmail.com, Bicycle on Threads, Midnight Film Pod on Instagram, subscribe on Pocket Cast, YouTube Podcast, Spotify, rate and review it on Apple Podcasts, tell a friend, family member, or stranger. What's up, man? How we doing?
We are doing pretty well, yeah. Good day, you know, just had a wedding tomorrow. I'm relaxing today, so not too bad.
Nice, very cool. I got some plans coming up that we will talk about in the future.
Yeah.
I should have asked you off mic to be specific about what we can and can't talk about. But, you know, San Diego Comic Con is coming up. We can talk. We can say that. That is a fact of nature.
Yeah. Well, we can say that you know, there's...
Comic-Con's happening.
Comic-Con is happening, and we'll be there. I will be there as a panelist. So I can say that. I can't give any specifics, but if you're in you know, the area and you're going to Comic-Con, you know, stay tuned, because you know, I will have some information for you guys in the coming days and weeks about a panel that I'll be hosting. So
yeah, and I am also not under embargo to talk about my travel plans. For the first time ever, I will be traveling past the Mississippi, I'll be going west of the Mississippi for the first time. I was trying to think if I had gone past there at any point, but apparently not. I've gone to Florida, but there's only like one part of Florida that's past the Mississippi. They just did a thing the other day where there's a part of Tallahassee, apparently, that is so far west that it is one time zone away from Oregon, from parts of Oregon, which is crazy to think about. Did you know that?
I did not know that. I did not also know that's how you pronounce Oregon.
Oregon.
The Oregon Trail.
Anyways, I will be, for the first time, going to California, specifically San Diego, California, to be in the same area, let's say, of Comic-Con. Yeah. Me and Derek will be meeting up to do things. Yeah, can't wait. Sounds like fun.
It'll be cool. First time meeting in IRL, so that'll be exciting.
Yeah, I posted a thing to Derek from TikTok of this girl does these series of TikToks that are like, you know, she likes to riff a bit and her friend doesn't like to riff bits. And so it's just like, yeah, what if I just did this? And the guy's like, why'd you do that? She's like, I wouldn't. It's fine. And then the other one was like, meeting somebody for the first time in real life. And he's like, I'm excited. And the person's like, hey, cool. Good to meet you. She's like, just like a Labrador or a golden retriever. She has like golden retriever energy and the other person does it. So that was an apt TikTok to send you.
That was good stuff. Yeah. Appropriate.
So is this, I think you mentioned last year, was it, that you went to Comic-Con last year? That was your first one, right?
Yeah. Last year was my first Comic-Con, and I got in that year, but not as a panelist, but yeah, it was my first time going to any of them, Comic-Con, so that was pretty cool.
Yeah, this will also be not just busting my Western Mississippi cherry, but also my con cherry. It's going to be busted here as well. Yeah.
Wow.
lots of cherries be busted. Yeah, so I think that's
all over the place.
Cherries just blowing up everywhere. I'm trying to think of anything else we can talk about, but yeah, just very excited. My mom is not up on, you know, culture of this, nerd culture like this, and she's like, so is it like just a little fan get together? I was like, yeah, sure, not little, but not little by any means. I showed her how many people go there, and she's like, what the fuck, that many people go there at once? How? It's like, it's fine. So yeah, I got all the travel plans figured out, got all that stuff figured out. Yeah, should be a good time.
Yeah.
She was asking me, that was the other thing. She's asking me like, what's food? what's good in the food world over there? And you can tell me, Derek, if I'm speaking out of pocket, talking out of school, that I said they're known for burritos, tacos, things of that nature.
Yes, Mexican food is very, very good in Southern California, specifically San Diego, which is very close to Mexico. I don't know if you've looked at a map, but
I did, yeah.
Yeah, there's a A lot of very good, very authentic Mexican food. Because I have been to, the Northeast. Is that what you are considered over there?
New England, yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. You know, and you guys have some good food, but Mexican food, not the best over there. But, man, yeah, there's some good Mexican food over here. So definitely burritos, tacos, all that good stuff. Get some carnitas, what have you.
Yeah, I've always heard it's like West Coast does burritos, they do Mexican food, East Coast does Chinese food, and Asian cuisine usually is the way that goes. But like I said,
I mean, there's some good Asian food out here too. I don't know if you heard about like back in the 1800s, but a lot of Asian people did come to California as well.
True. I was going to say about Chinese food. They have big Colombian condition here, big Colombian population here, I should say. So very good Colombian food here that I get quite frequently. It's very, very good. Yeah.
Nice. Well, yeah. I'm ready for you to have some authentic, delicious Mexican food.
Yes. I'm trying to think of a way to segue into our first story, but I can't. So I will just say, Evangeline Lilly says she wants to step away from acting. You know her from Lost. I know her. We both know her from the Ant-Man and Wasp movies, right?
Yeah, absolutely. And also, of course, everyone will know her as Toriel from the Hobbit trilogy.
A classic Toriel character. I haven't seen the Hobbit movie, so let me throw out a guess here.
Really?
Yeah, Toriel sounds like a dwarf. Was she a dwarfing character?
No, she was an elf.
She was an elf.
Toriel. Yes, it's very Toriel. She does have the hots for one of the dwarves, though.
Oh, yeah, okay. The one thing I heard about that whole trilogy was that obviously you took one book and stretched into three movies. So at a certain point, you got to come up with a little extra material to pad out the runtime, right? So that was apparently something that was not in the Hobbit book, correct?
She is a character that was invented for the films.
Oh, wow. Okay. Yeah. I didn't realize it was that bad. I thought they were just made up the relationship. Yeah. Wow. All right.
Yeah, there is a character called Toriel, like an elf, but they're from like another age or something like that. It's not the same Toriel.
Yeah. So she's only 44, quite young. Obviously.
Makes me feel very old because I think of like I was watching Lost the other day and I was like, she was like an adult when I was watching this as a kid. And I'm like, no, she's 10 years older than me.
She was just talking about that and being Lost, reflecting on that. She said, quote, "I'm terrified to admit this to the rest of the acting world, but ideally 10 years from now, I'd like to be a retired actress," she said in a video that surfaced from 2006. So, yeah, I mean, it just seems like one of those things you I don't know. I think I've been thinking a lot about like fame and how I can deal with that. And I just I've had interactions on just myself on Discord of just like, somebody will mildly disagree with me. I'm like, shut the fuck up and eat shit and die. And so I just imagine being somebody that's, you know, that famous, been that famous for, you know, that long, has had some.
And
know,
also as a famous anti-vaxxer.
Anti-vaxxer, yeah. I was just about to get that to that. It's just.
Sorry, cut you off there.
That's okay. It's just, man, I. You know, she can do what she wants, obviously, but I just have a lot of sympathy for people that, do this, do the entertainment gig, you know, for a while.
Yeah.
And, if you want to step away, go right ahead, you know?
Yeah, because she basically went straight into fame with Lost, because before Lost, she was doing, like, phone sex ad commercials, like, really? Was her biggest thing. Wow. Yeah, like, you can, like, I remember, like, that was a whole thing where, like, people were like, oh, yeah, this was, like, because she was, like, Canadian, and they're, like, she's in all these Canadian phone sex ads, I think. And I was like, you know, because like obviously like Matthew Fox had been on like Party of Five and stuff like that, but she was a real newcomer, unlike a lot of the other cast.
That's crazy. I didn't know anything about that phone sex ad thing. Being the elder millennial I am, the thing I always think about when I hear about phone sex ads and phone sex workers is when Rocco's Modern Life, when the Rocco took a job as a sex worker, sex hotline worker, and he's talking to like his neighbor. And he's just reading the script and he goes, "Oh, baby, oh, baby, oh, baby, oh."
Oh, my God. That's a deep memory.
Oh, baby, oh, baby, oh, baby. Rocco. Mrs. Bighead.
That is a deep memory. Yeah, I just brought that out for you.
Yep.
All right, so moving on, I got some casting news from the newest Benoit Blanc film, quote, Wake Up a Dead Man, Knives Out 3, some casting news, a lot of casting news. The last one always had, the last one had a big cast, first one had a big cast, so Benoit Blanc is coming back apparently, going to be out sometime in 2025, which, you know, sounds like a long time away, but it's actually, you know, 6 months from now, we're actually 6 months into 2024, so that's not that far away. So casting news, if you don't want to know anything about the movie, you know, scroll forward a little bit, but major casting announcements for Dead Man. Wake Up Dead Man, the third movie in the Knives Out trilogy. We got Josh Brolin in here, one of the biggest names. Mila Kunis. We got Thomas Hayden Church, which I just talked about fairly recently because I watched Sideways for the first time. We got Kerry Washington, Glenn Close, Jeremy Renner, which he was the biggest name in here because his name was brought up in the last movie talking about his hot sauce collection. So it'd be interesting to see if they reference that reference in the third one, right?
Right, yeah. Is it going to be an Ocean's 12 situation?
Exactly. With not Julianne Moore. What's her name?
Julia Roberts.
Julia Roberts, thank you, yeah. One of the biggest announcements is just because I think of Andrew Scott as somebody that, you know, he's obviously been in supporting roles, but for some reason, it's just he seems like an actor that's his stature, his A-list status seems to me like he should be leads. He should be playing leads a lot more than he does, right? Or am I just making that up?
No, he seems like a big name. You know, you kind of forget that he's mostly in ensembles or like supporting roles or smaller indies.
So he'll be in this. We also have an actor named Daryl McCormick, I'm not super familiar with. But we also have Josh O'Connor, another guy that just seems like he broke out, you know, with Challengers. So maybe after this, he'll take on more leading roles. And a female actress that's is she non-binary? Kaylee Spaney?
I don't believe so. I think, yeah, she identifies as female, I believe.
Okay. So she is, you know, Alien Romulus this year, Civil War this year, Priscilla late last year, Into this year, is rounding out the cast of Wake Up Dead Man. So pretty cool news there, right?
Pretty. Like, I love it when they just, like, you know, I remember last time that they were, like, because, you know, Knives Out obviously had a huge cast, and then last time they were announcing the cast, it's kind of in drips and drabs for the last Knives Out movie. It was like during deep pandemic, and it was like that was the only thing we had to keep going was more Knives Out casting news.
Yes. Yeah, that was deep pandemic. That was a part of the movie, right? Because they were like spraying them with some sort of vaccine when they were getting in the boat.
Yes. Yeah, that was a guy? Textual in the film. It was Ethan Hawke was the guy who like sprays him with like the stuff or whatever.
Yeah, that was very funny. All right, so that should be pretty cool. Also something, you know, it'll be in theaters, hopefully. Hopefully it'll be in theaters. You know, what was the Hitman was in theaters for like 2.5 days before hitting Netflix. So, man, they need to stop that shit. It's like, well, do you want theaters to come back? Then stop doing this shit, you know?
Well, the Netflix doesn't is the thing. That's the whole thing of it. I actually had a really interesting conversation on an episode of Underrated that's not out yet with Phil Iskov about Netflix and the drawbacks and the things that they're doing that are good and not so good. But yeah, like that was something we were both really pissed about, was just like Netflix is not letting their movies come out in theaters pretty much.
So, I mean, best case scenario, right? We're never going to have best case scenario. I understand that, but putting a movie out in theaters, if you are the distributor, you're gonna make money off of that. You know, I assume not as much if you're only doing streaming, but isn't it in Netflix's best interest, and also movie theater's best interest, and also the filmmaker's best interest, just to do a little bit of both? You know, not a day, like fucking 6 weeks, 8 weeks, something. You know, why even bother at that point?
Netflix, I think, is leaving a lot of money on the table. I think that they should adopt a model more like what Apple is doing, which was having like a full theatrical release. Like, it's still like these movies like Napoleon and Killers of the Flower Moon. They're still Apple original movies that go exclusively on Apple, but they also have like a real theatrical window for those things. I think that even though they might not like necessarily make a ton of money, in at the box office. That's not really their drive. I think there's a couple reasons Netflix doesn't do it. One being that, you know, they want to kill theaters, I think. And two being it has to do with a lot of back end deals with like actors and stuff like that, is and writers and you know, all the people behind it. They have to give them more money based on theatrical returns and stuff like that, I think is a big reason why they don't, which yeah. is bullshit. But, you know, whatever. what are you going to do?
Yeah, speaking of the box office, we got the summer movie wager. Bam, 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 bam. Bam, bam. Summer movie wager 2024 is heating up. We're in the middle, or not the middle, beginning of June. But, you know, we're getting to, you know, because the movie season starts, summer movie season starts pretty early. We're sort of, you know, maybe 20% of the way, 30% of the way. Anyways, we're into the season here. We got six movies fighting for contention right now. I skipped out on two of them. I skipped out on Garfield, the movie, and I completely whiffed on Bad Boys, Ride or Die. Didn't even think of it. But yeah, pretty contentious right now. So right now, speaking to you from the future, from the past, it's June 10th. So it might change by tomorrow. But right now, as we speak, my account has 19 points. Which is 5 points away from the leader, Peter Cerretta, just in the like the five or six people that are on the leaderboard right now, of the, you know, podcasters of the Slash Film Court, they are there. I'm like in third place for them. Derek, it looks like you got 17 points, so pretty even so far.
Yeah, I also did not put Garfield on, and I only put Bad Boys Ride or Die at number 10. So. You know, it's still very, very early, you know.
Yeah.
I have you of the people on the of I'm in out of the eight people, including us and then all the people who chose from the podcast. I have me tied for six and you at number five. I don't know what you're looking at, but
sorry, yeah, I said third, I'm fifth, yes. Okay. I was just saying, I think third if you count, because David and Jeff are tied at 22 points. Mm-hmm. So if you take that into consideration, I'm kind of like third. I'm kind of like,
and you would also even still be in fourth, but still, whatever.
one question I had for you, because I was looking at your dark horses, and I'm like, really? You put that in your dark horse?
Dark horse. That's the whole point.
You put if in your dark horse, like bad movie, yeah. Like is not doing well at the box office, true, but it's also second. So it's like, I don't know.
Yeah, it's second now. Like,
yeah.
Because it, I mean, that's the thing. If it's like, if is weird, right? Yeah. Because it is underperforming, but it's also not. Like it had a really soft open, but it's been having legs. So, you know, it's number two right now, but the thing is none of the heavy hitters have come out yet.
Right.
So
yeah, of course.
You know, it's something that, it did, I think, just recently pass up Fall Guy to move into that number two spot. Which Fall Guy really underperformed. So we'll see how stuff goes. That's why I put it in my dark horse, because I was like, you know what? I could see, I don't want to completely leave it off my list, because it could be a moneymaker or it could be a complete flop. And it's kind of seems like it's in the middle of those two things right now.
Yes, you're correct. One of the big releases of the summer, one of the biggest, if you go by predictions here, Inside Out 2 is going to be released in between our recording schedules here. So why don't we make a prediction right now? How do we think Inside Out 2 is going to do? Let's say, you know, opening weekend, I'm going to say probably 60 million. Just, you know, if you know, COVID didn't happen, let's say we're in a healthier space with movie theaters, with movies in theaters, right? I would never say 60 to 70 million. But right now, just because of the way the box office has been trending, I'm going to say 60 to 70 million opening weekend. What do you say?
I'm going to go higher. I'm going to just, and this is just based on nothing because I don't have any of the predictions or anything in front of me, but I'll say 80 million. Because I think this movie is going to do very well. I had it, I think, a lot higher in my predictions than you did. I think I had it at my number, I guess I had it at my number three.
Yep.
Yeah, so.
Let me see where. Yeah. Yeah, you had it at number three, correct? I had Inside Out 2 pretty high at... No, I didn't. At number seven.
Yeah,
so,
you had seven, yeah.
Yeah, that's not good. That guy fucking Craven. Jesus, Craven's still on there. God damn it. Yeah, Alien Romulus could do numbers, but yeah.
That's why I was the only one who put it on my list proper of us and all the film pod.
I think unfortunately, are we going to record before Quiet Place Day One? Let me see. That's the 28th. Depends on when we record. So I'm gonna say that's not gonna do well at all. And also Horizon, American Saga. I think those are going to be bad returns. Now, again, is the movies going to be bad? No. Is the box office should be better? Yes. But talking about what we know so far, what we've seen so far, I'm going to say those are not going to be good returns at all. Unfortunately.
Yeah, this is the thing with this summer. It's so hard to predict and it's so weird because pretty much everything is underperforming. I guess Bad Boys had a good opening. Kingdom of the Planet of the Apes has been doing well, but almost all the other summer movies have been underperforming by a lot. So you know, and yeah, I didn't put the Horizon fucking movie on my predictions or my star courses. I was like, are you kidding me? Kevin Costner's vanity piece? No, thank you. I don't think that's gonna make money. There's not enough 80-year-olds in the country. They're all dead.
Yeah, there's more than I would prefer. Let's put it that
sure,
way.
Sure. But they're not going to the theater. They're staying at home.
Speaking of death and dying, let's get to what we've been watching. I got quite a few things on here, so remind me to do back and forth as much as I can. Right. So, first off, we got In a Violent Nature. This was highly anticipated by me. I don't think I put it on any list, but you know, in my soul, I was anticipating it in my soul because I love slashers. I love gross things. That's just me as a person. In a Violent Nature is a 2024 Canadian slasher film written and directed by Mr. Chris Nash. I believe this is a directorial debut, starring Rye Barrett, Andrea Pavlovich, and Lauren Marie Taylor. It's described as an ambient slasher. So the way they describe this on the Big Pick, and the way I'll describe it as well, is like if Terrence Malick directed Friday the 13th. It is lugubrious at certain points. This is has a lot of takes a lot of his tones from like Sasquatch Sunset. Try saying that three times fast.
Okay.
So it is just a movie that was promoted and had this gimmick of, yeah, the whole movie is from the killer's point of view. And just to talk about
this one. I've heard this one.
So to get into little details, do you want me to tell you if that holds true throughout the entire movie or not?
Sure.
Yeah. No, it does not. It absolutely does not. Not even close. So they cut back. They cut to one of the big points of the movie is that point where that trope of, you know, kids or teenagers or 20 something sitting around a bonfire at night telling spooky stories. And of course, they tell the story of the slasher. I forget what the guy's name is. Let me see if I can. It's on here. What is the killer's name? Aurora Brody. I should have pulled this up later, but anyways, let's say the killer, whatever his name is, Johnny. Okay, his name is Johnny. Goes around killing people. They tell the story of Johnny, what happened to him. He's like a kid, very similar to the Friday the 13th story of a kid dies. He was like, what was the story? It was so like, you know, offhanded and just okay. That's very silly. I can't even think of it right now. But anyways, they're telling the story, and the guy is in the background. You can see him standing there in the background. Menacingly standing there watching the kids tell the story, and then it comes back to him and sort of watches him. It's interesting just in the sense of like you're watching the killer, like, well, you know, all these slasher movies are from the people's point of view of them watching them get ready, watching them take their clothes off, watch them take showers, watch them, you know, whatever, right? And you hear noises in the background, you're like, you're wondering what the killer is doing all this time, and this answers that question of like, you know, what are these killers doing on their free time? What are they doing as they're walking around hunting these people? Are they making decisions? Are they like just like a shark and they're smelling blood? Do they have any sort of cognitive decision making at all? And it's sort of in between. It's sort of like him just tunneling tunnel visioning towards the killers, towards the people, and just not giving a shit what's happening? Or is it him making, you know, calculated decisions of like, oh, there's one of them, let me split him off, or there's like three of them, let me split one off and pick them off one by one, or just go berserker mode? And it's a little bit of both. It's one of him is just walking up to them in a campsite. One of the main set pieces is him walking up to like the sheriff that killed him, you know, 10 years ago, or whatever it was, and walking up to the sheriff, describing how to kill him and what happened and why he's indestructible, you know. So one shot is him just walking up and just getting shotgunned in the face. And it's a locked camera from his POV on the ground. And you can see the characters in the background explaining, okay, we got to get the chains on him, put him back on the ground, and you got to give him the necklace. Do you have the necklace? No. Oh my God, who has the necklace? And shit like that. So it's a lot of that stuff.
Right.
I'll finish up and just say it's one very, very memorable kill, one disgusting kill, one kill people will be talking about for a long time. But overall, really didn't work for me. You know, I was promised a gross out film from beginning to end from the killer's point of view, and that's not what it delivered. But overall, I would say it's worth watching if you just want a good slasher. It's like a, you know, 85-minute slasher with one very inventive, very memorable kill.
Okay. All right. Yeah. So you would recommend I check it out then?
Yeah, if that's your thing. if you got a little gremlin inside you that just wants some gross out blood for, you know, 85 minutes, then go for it. But if you're not a person that seeks this sort of stuff out, then I would say maybe skip it.
Okay. All right. Good to know.
Yes.
I mean, I'm kind of lukewarm on a lot of slashers, yeah, if I'm being honest, so I might skip this one.
Yeah. So let's go to you. You watched a movie that I'm sort of interested in, just because I'm interested in, you know, the movie industry itself and how we're sort of navigating these uncharted waters. You checked out Movie Pass Movie Crash on Max, the one to watch for HBO.
Yes, I watched Movie Pass Movie Crash on Max, formerly known as HBO Max, formerly known as HBO. this is interesting because, you know, I love a good documentary, and I also love a good documentary about like the film business and film stuff, and also a good documentary about just like a failure. You know, like I watched both those Firefest documentaries. I thought it was really interesting. And yeah, this movie, you know, I had a movie pass. Did you have a movie pass, Damien?
I did not, only because we don't have any AMCs near me.
Well, no, because the movie pass thing was good for any.
Oh, really?
Movie theater. Like, it was good for anywhere.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. So this, you know, this is before, like, the AMC pass or anything like that.
Oh, gotcha, gotcha.
Yeah, and this was just, like, some guys, these two black guys, Stacy Spikes and Hamish, I forget the other guy's name, but, you know, it's this black startup, you know, kind of getting in, sort of disrupting the industry a little bit. And, you know, you can see how they've changed things now because, you know, you brought the AMC pass and like the Regal pass, and every movie theater has a pass like this now where instead of buying a movie ticket, you buy like this monthly subscription that I have my AMC pass and I love it. But this is kind of talks about how the early growing pains of this company and how, you know, they started out and then they ended up bringing in another guy to help run it, and then that guy brought in another guy, and then all of a sudden the two black founders who co-created the company had gotten kicked out of it, and you know, we're hoping that, well, I hope they don't kill the company in a year so that we can actually sell our stocks, because we're locked into our stocks because we got kicked out of our own company. And you know, people who know what happened with MoviePass might know what happened there, but yeah, this is really just a like fascinating documentary. It feels like, honestly, it feels like a lot of the video essays that I watch on YouTube and stuff like that.
Yeah.
Just, you know, with done with the, you know, actual people in it, like, you know, all the people involved in the MoviePass company, and it's like, you know, huge crash and burn and the way it disrupted everything. But was this, I mean, when I had my movie pass, I was like, this is incredible. Paying $10 a month and seeing unlimited movies, pretty much. It was like one movie a day. You could see, and I was like, this does not seem viable, because they're not actually associated with the theaters. They just buy you. They mail you essentially a debit card.
Yeah.
And yeah, buy basically just would buy you a ticket whenever you would go to see a movie. And obviously, they went burning through millions of dollars. The company was really mismanaged. They had like a Coachella party that for no reason. It's interesting. And I just kind of wonder, I'm like, what is really the difference between this and a really well-made video essay where they do have access to the people who made it, you know, like, because I've watched a lot of really great video essays that actually have access to the people that they're talking about. And I really don't think that there is a difference at this point, whether it's on Max or on YouTube, you know. It's just, I think that I was thinking about that a lot watching the movie as well. I don't know. What do you think about that?
I think it's interesting because I watched a movie. I'll just bring it up now just to tell you that I know what you're talking about. Gasoline Rainbow is a movie. Let me just pull up the Wikipedia real quick. Second movie from Bill Ross and Turner Ross. It's about five teenagers going from a small town in Oregon, and they're going on a road trip. So to answer your question about, like, you know, the separation between video essay and a documentary and how those lines are blurring very, very quickly. This movie, Gasoline Rainbow, very much blurs the line between a blog and a travel blog and a documentary and things like that. So, yeah, I definitely know what you're saying with the production value and the editing and the research and the all that stuff in a documentary that we'll talk about later. Definitely does feel like the MoviePass movie crash definitely does feel like that, where it's like, well, how did you see this, by the way? Did you see it in a theater?
No, I watched it on
Max. You mentioned Max. So yeah, just again, the at-home feeling. I watched Gasoline Rainbow at home. So it very much does feel like since you're watching these on home, and probably you watch on the same device you watch like a video essay on, right?
Yeah, I could just put it up on my TV either way, honestly, you know?
So yes, I definitely know what you're talking about with that weird blurring of the lines where the tech is more readily available. It's, you know, they have that prosumer term for tech that probably these guys use and probably the Gasoline Rainbows guys use, where it's just, the guys that are selling movies to Sundance and the guys that are quote unquote in Hollywood and are going through that Hollywood pipeline are using a lot of the same tech and that people that make video blogs and make video essays are using. So yeah, it's a very interesting time for this stuff.
Yeah, and Kevin Perger, who he's the guy who does Defunct Land and does all those, you know, he's talked about in his documentaries. He's like, I'm at this point where it's like, do I still describe myself as a YouTuber? And he's like, it feels pretentious, but I've started describing myself as a documentarian, because that's what he does. He makes documentaries. They're like indistinguishable from a documentary you would see on Max or Netflix or something like that.
Yeah, I would be very interested to, you know, make a documentary about documentaries and about, because I think I sent you a TikTok, I think I sent you a couple times, and you're like, yeah, you sent me this one already. It was the one where it's the woman who's working at like the mung bean factory, and she's talking about like zoning out and thinking about life, thinking about death, and thinking about time and how her pug is getting older. And I was like, Jesus Christ, this TikTok made me cry like a movie or a commercial or whatever. So TikToks and blogs and all of these things are blurring so quickly. I think it's very interesting to sort of like, when I talk about this stuff and talk about it to people that aren't, you know, as steeped in as you and I are, I never say like I saw TikTok. I never say I watched it on YouTube. I always say like I either watched a documentary or watched a movie or watched whatever. I never say TikTok or YouTube. Like you said, the guy was like saying, you know, do I call myself a YouTuber at this point because of the negative connotation to that? So yeah, it's a very interesting time for all of this stuff.
Yeah, most definitely.
Yep. That was your movie pass movie crash on Max, the one to watch for HBO right now. You can check that out there. And I'll just pivot to Bloody Nose Empty Pockets, since I talked about Bill Ross and Turner Ross's new movie that you can watch on Mubi, that is streaming right now. But Bloody Nose Empty Pockets was their first documentary released in 2020, at Sundance. It is about on the eve of the presidential election, about a dive bar in Las Vegas named the Roaring Twenties. And it's just sort of observing. It's very observational documentary. It's very, what's that word I can never remember? That phrase, it's like a documentary, but it looks like real life, but it might be dramatized.
Mockumentary?
No, it's like a mockumentary, but it's real. It's all real people. It's no script. It's not scripted at all. It's just talking about the regulars and talking about the barflies and talking about the bartenders there as they're shutting down the bar for the last time, but also during it's on the eve of the presidential election. So some political discussions there, but mostly it's just about the people and their lives and them, you know, talking drunkenly about, like, you know, I'm sorry I wasn't there for you during your loss. I'm sorry I wasn't a better friend or a person or daughter or whatever. So yeah, very, very good. It's one of those I've heard talk about a lot on Film Spotting. I think they gave this their Golden Brick Award, which is the award they give to directorial debuts from the past year. So they gave that award to the Ross brothers. So yeah, definitely check it out. It's streaming right now on Canopy, on YouTube, on Mubi, and yeah, definitely recommend checking it out.
All right, I will have to check that one out.
Yeah, it's very good. Let's go back to you, to The Young Woman and the Sea. This is actually something I didn't even hear about until I heard Daisy Ridley in a couple podcasts talking about it. What'd you think of this?
Yeah, so this is one that I guess it was originally supposed to be a Disney Plus original, and it kind of seems that way, you know, watching. I thought it was, and then I was like, oh, it's in theaters. And I guess originally they planned to make it a Disney Plus thing, and then they tested well, so they're like, you know, let's release this. So kind of like we were talking about, like, yeah, like, you guys are making these movies, put them in theaters, make some money. Who would think that's a good idea, right? This movie, it kind of snuck up on me. Like, starting out watching, I was like, all right, this is your basic, you know, 3-star movie. It's pretty good, you know, like, whatever. Yeah. It's just kind of like, oh, these ladies been wanting to swim. Crazy. It's 1910, you know, whatever. And you're watching and you're like, all right, you know, this is very, very, like corporate, like, you know, corporate trying to, like, go for, like, yes, look at us. We care about equality, and we'll show you that by showing you that we care about women being able to swim, you know, or whatever. but then it started to go on, and I was like, all right, this is kind of getting me a little bit. And then in the middle, I was like, this is effective. I like this. This is some good stuff. I think it's some Daisy Ridley's finest acting.
Nice.
And then by the end, I was like almost crying. I was like, this movie's so fucking good. Like, it really feels like those movies that would be on Disney Channel in the 90s, or like that Disney would make in the 90s, like Iron Will, like these inspirational, based on a true story.
Yeah.
The story of a woman who swam the English Channel. And no one, and you're like, but that like really hits you in the feels because they're just very earnest. And that's what this movie was. It was just a no nonsense, no, just like, you know, it wasn't hitting your head. It felt from a bygone era. Not from, like, you know, the 20s or whatever, but, like, it really felt like a 90s style sports, like true inspirational story. And I was really digging it, you know, some really great performances in this, not just from Daisy Ridley, but from, you know, the whole cast. Christopher Eccleston is just a real rat bastard in this. you've got the guy from Killing Eve, who plays Constantine Kim Bodiga. he plays her dad, and he's pretty great in it. I would honestly highly recommend this one. You know, it's like a classic, like, you know, Jerry Bruckheimer got the rights to it. It's like one of those movies, you know, it's like this script that, you know, was kicking around for a few years, you know, was gonna get made at Paramount, I guess, at one point, and then this, you know, this mega producer gets it and is like, all right, guys, let's put this out there. Let's make something with this. They did a very good job with this, you know?
It's very cool. Yeah, there's a couple that have come out recently like this. Again, talking about, I sound like a broken record, but people say they don't make these like they used to. They are. You're just not finding them. It's this.
Yeah.
It's Naiad. It's Boys in the Boat. You know, again, three movies about people in water, but three movies that, like you said, just great. Straight down the middle, fastball movie. That are really good, that they still make today. People just aren't watching it. It's got, I don't know how long they're going to release it in theaters or how long they plan to do that, but it's only made 581,000 at the box office. Just like, good Lord. Market this shit better.
I think that's the thing. It's just like, they were like, well, we could either make $0 at the box office, which is what they were going to do, or we could just put it out there. And I think they just put it out there, you know, and that's, you know, so it's like, all right, that's more than $0. So that's just money in their pocket, you know?
Yeah. Before we move to the next thing, the director of Young Woman in the Sea.
Young Woman in the Sea, yeah.
Director Joachim Rønning. Do you know what he has on deck?
I know that he did a Pirates of the Caribbean movie, so he had that on deck, as it were, you know, because,
Pirates. I see what you did there. Very good. is it a Disney? Yeah, it's a Disney property. Tron Ares next year. He's directing that. Okay. Yes.
All right. Pretty
stacked cast, actually. Jared Leto, which, you know, okay, that's a guy. And you know what's weird? Hold on. Why is he? Okay. I was going to say, on one part of the Wikipedia article, his name's not in blue. And it's like, wait, did he die? Was he just scrubbed from the record books? Like, what the fuck? But he has another link here somewhere else. So, Tron Ares, Jared Leto starring with Greta Lee, past lives Greta Lee, Evan Peters, Hasan Minhaj, Jodie Turner-Smith, Gillian Anderson, and Jeff Bridges, of course, is reprising his role. So, yeah, stack cast.
Oh, all right.
Yeah,
That's pretty cool. Yeah. I guess they're not bringing back Cillian Murphy, who they had even just cast in that movie just to be the villain in this one, but, you know.
I guess not. Yeah, I guess not. So there's that. Yeah. Just to rattle off a couple of things. That was the last thing you had to watch, right? You have watched. Yeah.
I did not. It was a slow week for me.
Yeah, that's fine. That's fine. So a couple of TV shows I caught up on. One finished. The one that finished was Hacks. Hacks on Max, the one to watch for HBO. This is its third season. Just trying to find the amount of episodes this season. 9 episodes, but it is 25 minutes, 30-minute episodes. So very, very, very digestible. I think they did the thing where they do 3 episodes to start with, then 3 more, and then 3 after that. So it did come out pretty quickly in quick succession. I love this show. I think this is one of the best shows on TV right now. I know there's a billion shows that people are vying for your attention, but this is definitely one of the best, just in terms of writing, chemistry, talking about social issues and things like that. But in a very, you know, I think a lot of shows and TV shows and movies do this thing now where they just have like the old curmudgeon trying to, you know, understand this new vernacular, this new world that they're in with these people saying like, oh, what's your pronouns, blah, blah, blah. But I think this does that in one of the smartest ways where they just, you know, they talk about it. Jean Smart is Deborah Vance, the stand-up comedian, and Hannah Einbinder as her assistant, Ava. And they have these conversations about that, but it's very quick and it's very like just don't say that. And she's like, and Deborah's like, okay, fine, whatever. Smart Alec, Gen Z bullshitter, whatever, fine. they have an amazing cast of people in here. I don't know if you can pull up the Wikipedia, but it's just people you've never really heard of. But if you click on them, you're like, oh, I know that face. I think the writer of the show, Paul Downs, has a great character named Jimmy and has great chemistry with his assistant, Kayla. She's like this airhead daughter of Jimmy's boss she's like, you know, what do you call that? The nepo thing where she's just like, you know, got the job because it's her father, but she actually has some skills, but she's mostly just annoying. Just annoying to be around. I love their dynamic. Yeah, very, very good show. One of the best, like, you know, rom-coms. And again, talking about things that it's a sitcom, but it's, you know, it's situational more than comedy. But it's just very good. I love the ending. The ending of this season was one of my favorite things I've seen in a very long time, just because they have this dynamic, which is, you know, I'm writing for you, but I want to write for myself, and I'm going to leave the nest, and I'm going to do my own thing. They've done that a couple times for the last couple seasons, and they were sort of retreading that ground again this season. But second to last episode, and the last episode, and the way the last episode ends, just like, holy shit, that was a very good tweaking of the dynamic, tweaking of the whole system, the way that they've done their back and forth thing. I just cannot wait for the next season. Really, really good. Highly recommend Hacks. Yep. Nice.
All right. It's a show, like, you know, there's just so much stuff. So I've been wanting to watch it. I love Gene Smart. So, yeah. I mean, I'll get to it at some point.
Yeah. Yeah. All 3 episodes are available on Max right now. Speaking of things in theaters that people don't go to see, the re-release of Wizard of Oz, 85th anniversary of Wizard of Oz. It's still good. Still that movie. quick 85 minutes. You know, effects still hold up. On the big screen, you can see the little person hanging in the background, which wasn't a little person. It was.
It's an emu.
It's an emu. Exactly. It's an emu that unfurled itself at the very last second, which I could see very clearly on the big screen. This is my first time seeing this movie on the big screen. It looks incredible. You know, the effects definitely hold up. The background, the acting, the songs. Yeah, great stuff.
Yeah, I mean, Wizard of Oz, classic movie.
one of the big ones, yes.
Not a maybe class. I would say maybe the movie that the most people have seen it ever in history. I would say, like, if I had to guess a movie, I think it's that one. Like, either that or like Star Wars. Maybe I think those are like, who hasn't seen the fucking Wizard of Oz? You know, like,
yeah, the movie that's classic that everyone's seen and transcends, you know, generations. It can work for many different generations. It's family friendly. It's short. Great songs. Great performances.
Everybody shows it to their kids. You know.
Yeah, exactly. So yeah, great movie. It wasn't on your docket. It wasn't on the synopsis. So I'm assuming you did not check out Hitman. It's apparently two words. Didn't realize that. That's why I was looking for it everywhere. And it's two words, Hit/Man. Did you check this
out? There you go. Yeah. I did not check this one out. I am not a big Linklater guy other than his Before trilogy. I don't like his movies. I remember his one last year, the Apollo 13 and a half or 12 and a half, whatever it was called.
10 and a half, I think it was. Apollo 10 and a half, yeah.
10 and a half. Yeah, did not like that one at all.
All right.
So, yeah, I am not on his level. So I considered watching this because it was such a sparse week.
Yeah.
And I was like, maybe I just watch this to have something to talk about. But then I remembered that I had my my expansion pass for my Switch. Then I've been playing all... That's why part of the reason why I don't have anything on here is I've been just been playing Majora's Mask all week.
Nice.
I even got the actual N64 controller. Like, it's a Switch controller, but it's actually an N64 controller. So I've been using that. So I'm back to the year 2000.
That's cool. Like, it connects by Bluetooth, or it's got a cord there or something.
Yeah, I mean, it works just like a regular. It is like a Switch controller, but it's like in the
configuration
body and shape of in configuration of a N64 controller. So it connects to the Switch and everything, but it's pretty cool. And you know, I guess I'll count this as something I've been watching.
Yeah,
myself play Majora's Mask because there's this like I was on this other podcast a while ago about like called the Old Switcheroo, where they play all the games that are on the Switch, all the retro games that are on the Switch.
Yep.
And they have if you buy the expansion pass for like $50 a year, you can play like all of these classic games, like a ton of stuff from 64, a ton of stuff from like Nintendo, Super Nintendo, Game Boy, Game Boy Advance, you know, the Sega Genesis. So I've been playing a lot of stuff. I've been playing some Kirby and the Crystal Shards, you know, some Star Fox, all the classics from back in the day. I was like, all right, I am getting my money's worth on this one.
Nice. Is that all in like one package? How are you getting those? It's all in
So it's just like you just pay the subscription fee and then you can just go on. There's like different. You just like go click. I want to play the N64, and then it takes you to the list of all the games and you choose one. You're like, all right, boot up Majora's Mask or boot up Star Fox or Kirby or whatever. Or like, all right, I'm done with that. I'm gonna go. You just download the pack or whatever for Game Boy, and it's like, all right, cool. Here's like 70 games for Game Boy. Maybe not that many, but like it's like, all right, you just go. You choose. All right, I'm gonna play Golden Sun. You know, and you boot that up or whatever.
So I wonder if you playing Golden Sun, how that mechanic works without the what is the sun? What do they call those? It's the thing that makes it so you can know if you're in the sunlight or not. What are those called?
I don't know. Was that a thing?
The game you're talking about, not Golden Sun. What was it called?
I said Golden Sun, so I don't know what game you're talking about.
Yeah, Golden Sun was the one where it played differently whether you were in the sun or not. Right?
I don't think so.
Was there another game I'm thinking of that does that? Oh, okay. I was not thinking of Golden Sun. I was thinking of Boktai, the sun is in your hand. Have you heard of this?
Oh, of course. No, I've never heard of Boktai, the sun is in your hand. Of course, I can see how you'd get that confused. They both have sun in the title.
Boktai, the sun is in your hand. Is an action adventure role playing game. Yes.
Okay. It's funny because the guy who I'm in the Discord for that Old Switcheroo, and he also confused those two games. That's really funny. So I guess it's not just you.
It's not good. That's good. The game's cartridge has a photometric light sensor which measures light exposure. In order to change the in-game solar weapons, the player must take their Game Boy outside in the daytime, as verified by the light sensor. If the player's gun battery runs out of light reserves and there is no sun available, then the player must avoid conflicts with the enemy or find an in-game solar station to recharge. That's pretty cool.
Don't play this game if you live in the Arctic Circle, I guess, and it's
Yeah.
just like nighttime for 6 months or whatever.
Exactly. So yeah, let's see where we at here. Hitman. Hitman was the thing we were talking about
Right, yeah,
originally.
Hitman.
Hitman, starring, of course, the guy of the moment, Glenn Powell. Got Glenn Powell. We got Ariana Arona from Emerald City, an Oz book adaptation. She was in the TV show Good Omens, which I heard really good things about, but I haven't checked out. And she was Bix Colleen in Andor, which we have both checked out and enjoyed very much. Austin Amello, who's Dwight in The Walking Dead and the spin-off
She's
Fear the
also, of course, in Morbius. You forgot that one.
Walking. Of course, I could forget Morbius. We also have we have an actress here who I see her all the time, and it's just I like her a lot, but I just associate her with The Good Place. Not The Good Place. This person.
Oh, Parks and Rec.
Is she
Retta.
was she in Parks and Rec? I believe yes, you're correct.
Yep.
Yeah, I associate her with Parks and Rec. So, yeah,
No,
Hitman.
she wasn't actually she wasn't she was not in Parks and Rec. She was in Bowtie Kai, The Sun in Your Hand.
You're right. I always mix up those two things. So Hitman. Hitman's a good movie. It's a good movie with great moments. Sean Fantasy didn't say that. He thinks this is a great movie. It's one of those that I like watched and I was like, that's fine. But then after, reading some things and listening to their feedback, I was like, okay, yeah, because of those things you mentioned and that you highlighted, yes, it's actually I will upgrade this from a 3 to a 3.5 because of the things you'd maybe realize. Yeah, it is a romantic action comedy, which again, they make those still, and this is a very good one of those. I do have some complaints. I have thoughts and complaints, and I have them in my notes. What do you think,
Oh,
Derek?
yes, I
Just
was supposed to remind you, pull up your notes.
thank you, thank you. What do you think, Derek? Just in general, when you're watching a movie, TV show, whatever, and they have a guy like they do with Superman and Clark Kent, where it's like nobody knows Clark Kent, Superman. How can that be? You have a guy like Glenn Powell playing a quote unquote nerd because he has glasses and a ponytail, or glasses and his hair is in a weird style, or wears jorts, and everyone around him is like, go, okay, Glenn, nerd, go be the pretend hitman. Let's see if you can even do this, fucking nerd ass Glenn. Get the fuck out of here, nerd ass dork Glenn Powell with your swollen arms and cheekbones and shit. Stop it. Stop it, Hollywood. Stop it. Are you as annoyed at these, it's just golden goddesses playing nerds as I am?
Oh yeah, like that one movie that did that really bugged me was and I liked the movie overall, but that's part of it bugged me was Lisa Frankenstein,
Yeah.
when people were like Catherine Newton is supposed to be this nerd loser who has no friends, and then she shows up like one day like in a different style, and everyone's like, "Have you seen her? She's so pretty. She's almost prettier than her sister." But like, it's Catherine fucking Newton. She's like one of the most beautiful people in the world. What the fuck are you talking about?
Yeah. The glasses and the ponytail I always pull from Not Another Teen Movie. I don't know if that was
Right.
a movie of your
He's got glasses and a ponytail. I remember
growing up.
that.
Yeah. The
That
way
was on
he
Comedy Central late night a lot.
Chris Evans, the way he delivers that line, ew, she's got glasses and a ponytail. Gross. Janie Briggs, the pretty ugly girl. Blah. Stupid. Anyways, let's try to get through Hitman. It's a very good movie. It's good performances, good writing. It's just not, great. It doesn't elevate to great in my mind. And I've seen, it's got like a 3.5 on Letterboxd. So it does very much seem like a 3.5 starred movie starring, that you can watch on a plane. Somebody asked me in the Discord, like, can I, oh, you saw that movie? How was it? I was like, yeah, it's pretty good. And he's like, oh, it's like a plane movie. I was like, yes, this is a
Yeah,
perfectly
a
fine,
plane movie. Yeah.
perfectly fine, throw this on a plane, you'll have a good time movie. I do want to say, just speaking about Richard Linklater overall, he has motifs that he returns to a lot. One
You
is
don't
like,
say.
one of them is, and because you've seen this, the before trilogy, they have those moments between Celine and Jesse where they're doing this like adopting a persona. They're on like a phone call and pretending to be other people, right? And they do this a very good, one of the best moments in the movie that elevated this from a 3 to a 3.5 for me. And for Sean Fantasy was this part at the end where they actually use a cell phone in a really smart way where they're having this conversation. It's not going to spoil anything because it's not going to mean anything. And I'm not going to reveal any plot points, but he comes into the room and he's using the cell phone and he's bugged. So you know, he's bugged, but they can't see what he's doing. So he has his phone out saying with the notes app saying, you know, I'm bugged, say this, pretend we're doing this, say, you know, that kind of thing. Mm-hmm. Works really well. It's like a dance, a choreographed dance. That works really, really well. That's just a motif that they have in the Before Sunset, Before Sunrise. They do that. A Skinner Darkly, they'll have moments in that. Bernie has moments like that. So, yeah, it's a very interesting motif that he returns to. And just the tone overall. And I don't know, Derek, if you've seen the movie I Love You, Philip Morris. Have you seen that film?
No, that's the one with like... the gay prison romance between Obi-Wan Kenobi and Jim Carrey, right?
Exactly. You nailed it. Yes. 2009 black comedy directed by John Requa and Glenn Ficarra. They directed that. I was like, what else did they direct? Oh, Crazy Stupid Love and the classic Whiskey Tango Foxtrot and Smallfoot. So I was like, what the fuck? But yeah, I love Philip Morris. I just cite that because they both have a similar sort of black comedy aesthetic to them.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. So you would recommend it then?
Yeah. If you want to kill 90 minutes, go ahead.
Okay.
It's a fine one of those. Yep. One more thing before we get to my Best Picture winning marathon. Another one I caught up with recently that's really picked up pace and really picked up its quality, I think, is Dark Matter. It's a show on Apple TV Plus, and I know there's so many shows on Apple TV Plus these days and just in general that are just like, it's the best show on TV. You know, what's the crime show, the detective show? Slow Horses. People are obsessed with Slow Horses. You know, it's that, I think it's got like 3 seasons on there already just because they can churn them out so quickly. And the guy wrote a bunch of books, so they're adapting those pretty quickly. So just a lot of shows on Apple TV Plus that fall through the cracks, like Sugar that I talked about recently. That was fine. Dark Matter is adapted from a book. It's a genre book. It's a science fiction genre book about multiverses. So, you know, I think you're either the person that's, you know, fed up with multiverses or we're at a point where we're just used to them. What do you think, Derek? Are we at a point where there's too many multiverse stories or have we hit peak multiverse is what I'm asking.
I think we have probably hit peak multiverse. So if you're going to do it, do something new with it, honestly.
Yeah. This does interesting things with it just in the sense that there is an original person and somebody else is coming into their life. And so the premise of it is Joel Egerton plays Jason and the other Jason that led a different life. Like our Jason, let's say our Jason, Jason 1, right? He got married, has a kid, has a life, has a very quiet life, right? And so the other Jason obviously did the opposite path. He took the opposite path of, you know, nose to the grindstone of science, of pursuing whatever he was trying to do, and didn't pursue the romance, didn't pursue the woman. So at a certain point, he discovers, multiverse travel, discovers how to do it, discovers, you know, Jason One's life, Jason One's world. But then he's like, okay, that's the life I didn't have. That's the path I didn't take. So let me try that. And so the entire rest of the show is Jason One trying to get back to his life because he meets one named Amanda, who was working under Jason 2. And so she knows all the science stuff. She has the capsules that they can use to travel the multiverse to try to get back to Jason 1's, to his world. And so I was talking about somebody in the Discord of just like, yeah, it's good, but they could drop like nine episode season. They could have done it like 4 or 5 episodes because they're right now just getting to the meat of the thing. And they're just now getting to one of my favorite parts of the book, which I guess I'll just talk about a little bit because you're probably not gonna watch the show and just that one episode, that one encounter doesn't really have anything to do with the rest of it. So he's traveling the multiverse. He gets to a place that looks like his own. He's like, oh my God, I finally found it. Finally found my world, my wife. They go to his apartment and it's kind of quiet. You know, it's basically normal, but nobody's on the street. There's like just this building sense of dread. And he goes home and his wife is there and she's like sick. So it's like, you know, COVID, that brings up COVID, that brings up pneumonia, all that stuff, like the one you're watching, the one I assigned to you. So he goes in, she opens the door. She's like, I don't want you to catch whatever I have. And they start talking for a second. And, you know, the police, the SWAT team, the army comes in down the street and Joel has to, Jason says, you know, I'm fine. I'm not sick or whatever. They give him they don't give him, they test him. He's like, you're good. They test his friend. She's good too. So they're like, you know, who's in the house? And he says, you know, it's my wife. She's sick. Can you help her? And like, nope. It's, once you get this, whatever it is, you're dead. You're just dead. And he's like, fuck. So he takes this, I don't know, methadrill or whatever it's called that they, you know, give somebody and just like slowly drift off or whatever. So they have that, you know, last conversation of, you know, sorry, this happened to you. I'm sorry, your son, their son is dead upstairs. You know, whatever happened, they had the son, they had the life, but it was all taken from them. So it's a very emotional scene, very, very well played out. So that scene right there should have been like episode 2 or 3. There's a lot of exposition. There's a lot of like them traveling to other worlds, which are also in the book, but it's just way too long. It's way too drawn out. And also, if I was to recommend this to somebody, I'd be like, okay, so I got to tell you the thing nobody likes to hear, which is, it gets better after episode 4. It's like, no, fuck that. No, fuck that. I'm not going to spend, you know, 4 hours getting through mid-tier stuff just to get to the good stuff. So unfortunately, right, unfortunately, that's what the show is. It gets very good on episode 5. So, yeah.
Okay. All right.
That's a Dark Matter.
I'll probably not watch it. I had no plans to, and I still don't.
Yep. Dark Matter on Apple TV Plus. They're up to episode 6. They have 3, 2, go. So with that, why don't we take a break so I can take a bathroom break and refresh. Refresh.
Sounds good.
All right. We'll be back after this. And we're back. Going to talk Best Picture winning marathon. My marathon is speeding up because I am just in the dregs of the 1960s musical renaissance, I guess we call it. Let me just pull up the actual list of all the best pictures. So I'm up to the mid-60s. Let me just pull up all the best picture winners. So I am 83% of the way done. I've seen 79 of the 95. Ooh. Yes, 79 of the 95 movies that have won Best Picture over the years. The movies I talk about today are Tom Jones from 1963, My Fair Lady from 1964, The Sound of Music from 1965, and A Man for All Seasons from The Year of Our Lord in 1966. I have notes. I have thoughts. I have – all right. Let's go back. Let's start with Tom Jones. Starring Albert Finney. My first note is Albert Finney. A young Albert Finney looks like Donald Trump, which sucks, honestly. Doesn't act anything like him. I don't think the man himself was anything like him, but because of his young face and just something about his hair makes him look like Trump in this movie. So I just copied and pasted this guy's name, the River Jordan's, his review. It was very raucous, misogynistic, and sexist. The buffoonery, an absurd Zucker Brothers by way of Monty Python absurdity, could only have been crafted by a myriad of producers, executives, and writers who were so doped up on various powders, pills, and booze that their blood would have been enough to kill a small horse. It is fucking ridiculous, dude. I've never seen anything like this outside of like UK movies that are like this. I don't know how it won Best Picture. I don't know how it was nominated for Best Picture. I don't know how people like this. This was ridiculous. This is like Barry Lyndon, right?
Oh, I love Barry Lyndon.
It's like Barry Lyndon, but made by a 12-year-old. Just like farts and poop jokes and sexist jokes and just awful, 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 awful. I give it like 2 stars on my Letterboxd. I have it at, let me see, where is it actually on my list here? I apologize. I should have all this stuff pulled up, but I don't. So basically, I have a list. I have a couple of lists here on Letterboxd. One of them is rankings of the best picture winners as I see them. So I've seen 40 so far during this marathon, right? And so I rank them all as I see them. I have Tom Jones ranked 35th out of 40 right now. The only ones worse were Cameroon, Grand Hotel, Broadway Melody, and Cavalcade. Some of the worst of the worst. Speaking of movies I've seen recently, speaking of movies in the bottom half or the bottom third of my ranking so far, My Fair Lady from 1964 stars Audrey Hepburn, Rex Harrison, and Stanley Holloway. Another long musical in almost 3 hours, comes in almost 3 hours. It's better made, I'll say that. the songs were better, not spectacular. The art direction was better, not spectacular. This is actually, Derek, my first exposure to Miss Audrey Hepburn.
Really? Okay.
Yeah, I was just curious if you know offhand how many Audrey Hepburns you've seen in your life. Everything pulled up. Have you seen Breakfast at Tiffany's?
You know what? I think I just recently watched my first Audrey Hepburn movie. Sabrina, I think, was the first one I had seen.
Letterboxd assignment.
the other
month there. Yeah, interesting.
I think that was the first. Yeah, because I was like, it's one of those things. Like, oh, everybody knows Audrey. I was like, I think this is the first one of hers I've seen. Yeah, that's the only one I'd seen. So yeah, honestly.
Same.
Huh? Yeah.
I just said My Fair Lady's gender and class politics are fucking gross. Oh, here's why I hate it. You ready for this?
All right.
For the first half of this movie, dude, is Audrey Hepburn doing a Cockney accent. Oh, governor! Oh, I'm this little peasant trainer and shit, governor. I don't know nothing about speaking good English. Now, miss, you say A, B, C. Oi, B, C. How did I do good, governor? Shut the fuck up. I don't care. It's shitty. It's such shitty jokes, man, about her and her class and her people. And speaking good English gets you into these clubs that you can make fun of other poor people in. Ugh, gross. Disgusting.
Here's the thing about this movie is that I believe, and you might want to fact check me on this, but I'm pretty sure, is that they changed the ending for the book, because in the book it's like, all right, well, all this stuff you tried to do, like, quote unquote, tame this woman, it's actually bullshit and you shouldn't do that to a person. But in the movie they're just like, and she's a respectable woman now, what do you know?
So, okay, I'll look up, I got the Wikipedia of the movie here, let me see. So it was adapted from a Leonard Lerner and Lowe stage musical based on Bernard Shaw's stage play Pygmalion. Pygmalion. I don't see anything about a book.
Maybe I'm thinking they changed the ending from the play. Then that's probably play, what I'm
thinking. So I'll just tell you the ending. It's just her, like, she gets all high and mighty, or, you know, she gets, you know, done up and is living in high society, right? And so she's like, I can just do anything now. I speak well and I can make money doing my, I can go my own way, blah, blah, blah. And so he's like, no, I actually love you now. Then that it made you into this beautiful woman. I love you. And she's like, I don't love you, you stupid piece of shit. You did all this for a bet? It was all based on a bet, is the thing. They had her sitting in the office and he's like, well, Higgins, I can make this little sheetage and I can make you part of high society. And he's like, no, you can't. I'll bet you 10 shilling you can't do that. And he's like, I'll bet.
Wait, so yeah. It's the exact same plot of Not Another Teen Movie. All right.
That and also
that we brought up earlier.
And Trading Places, basically. That. Trading Places is that, sort of, right? Was that?
Yeah, I would say, and She's All That, which is what Not Another Teen Movie is directly parodying.
Yeah, Shakespeare probably somewhere in there, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So the ending is just her, like, he's mourning her. He's like, oh, I lost her because I was mean to her. And so I'll just go off the Wikipedia here. He turns on his gramophone because he recorded her voice. She was doing, like, you know, what do you call it? Diction training. And so he was recording her to see how her progress was going. And so he's playing a recording he made of her during that point. And he's like, oh, I missed that. I missed that little Cockney accent. And then she shows up and she shows up behind him. Higgins nonchalantly asks, Eliza, where the devil are my slippers? Because that was the first thing he asked her when he met her. Cut to black. Mm-hmm. I'm just like, I'm just glad I'm gone. I'm glad I'm out. I'm out of these musicals. I have Oliver left, but that's the last of the musicals, of the 60s musicals.
And then another musical never won again. We thought for a second that one won in 2017, but they were like, no more musicals. Sorry.
Are you forgetting your beloved Chicago?
Chicago! I forgot that's the exception. That is the one.
Yeah. So I have upcoming on the docket, like I said, we're getting to the point where I've seen a lot of these. So I can skip a lot of these. Next is Oliver. Next, then after that, I saw Midnight Cowboy. So I'll be checking out Patton. Is that how you say it? I'm supposed to say it? Patton. That I can skip the next five. If I choose not, I can choose to skip the next five. Six. I saw French Connection. I saw Godfather. I saw The Sting. I saw Godfather Part 2. I saw One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest. And I saw Rocky. So my next one after that will be Annie Hall, which I saw like bits and pieces of a few years ago, but I will revisit it for this list. And I saw Deer Hunter. So that'll get me.
You're gonna fucking hate Annie Hall. Annie Hall is fucking awful.
So that'll bring me up to the 80. So I'll check back in next time. Any questions, comments, concerns, Derek?
I mean, I'm just saying, like, just listing the movies that you listed in the 60s and listening to the movies you listed in the 70s. It's amazing how just the culture changed with the Academy, right? Like,
yeah.
In the 60s, there's all these like grand displays of filmmaking prowess, and here's a musical starring. And then the 70s are all these like, and this is true of the wider just like filmmaking, you know, practices in both of those time periods. But the 70s are like these like emotional dramas that, and like you said, everyone has seen all of these movies. There are these huge fucking movies like The Godfather and shit like that that are like these massive cultural touchstones. So just it's interesting how like neatly like they break up between the 60s and then the 70s in terms of like eras of filmmaking and of Oscars.
Yeah, I would agree with that. It's always funny to me to see, like, you know, when we think about decades, let's take music, mm-hmm. right? It's like, oh, all the hippy dippy music and all of that stuff. Beatles were big in the 60s. Not really. Like, they were big in like 63 up to like, they were, and they, mm-hmm. they broke up in the late 60s. When people talk about like hippies and fashion, all that stuff like in the late 60s, you know, you watch like Mad Men. That's a very good representation of like the fashion of that time, because the first half of that show is like pretty regular style of like late 50s style of haircuts, and nobody had sideburns in the early shows. And then later on, as you get to the closer to the 70s, that's when the sideburns and all the wild hair starts coming in. And also, mm-hmm. like you said, with the movies, it's, you know, you think about, oh, it must have been all about the Vietnam War and civil rights and all that stuff. And yes and no, you have in the Heat of the Night wins in 67. So that's very much, you know, of the moment movie. But mm-hmm. you don't really get into the stuff we think about when we think about like the upheaval of cultural upheaval of the 60s doesn't really come into show in the movies up until like the late 60s, early 70s with Midnight Cowboy and French Connection and that stuff.
Yeah, exactly. The Oscars are always about like 10 years behind, which is why, you know, people are like, okay, well, Moonlight won, but you know, people were like, yeah, but Crash won the year of that Brokeback Mountain, you know. So yeah, they're like, we've solved racism. It's 2005, and they're like, we've moved on to other things now. We're not worried about gay people. Come on, Oscars, keep up.
Did I tell you about like that exact feeling you're talking about? Like, we solved racism. the same night. Or this, around the same time that Obama was elected was 2009, mm-hmm. like January, he becomes president. Like
2000, the election is in 2008. Yeah, yeah.
So he's president in 2009, but early 2009. Mm-hmm. Early 2009, the Oscars of that year was Slumdog Millionaire. So it's like, oh, we got it, guys.
Oh, right.
We got it.
Yeah,
you know, international movie, person of color winning best picture, person of color in the office. We got this. We're good.
We got it.
Yeah.
Danny Boyle, famous Indian.
One more thing I want to say, because I forgot to talk about the best movie I saw so far of this marathon and of the last couple of weeks is The Sound of Music. The emotional quality whiplash coming from My Fair Lady to The Sound of Music, from, you know, the camera was very static in My Fair Lady. It was very boring, unremarkable songs, very repeated, bland environments of My Fair Lady, and then just poof, you just bust the door open with the you know, the helicopter shot of the very beginning of Sound of Music. Julie Andrews, you know, upbeat, can sing, can dance, can do all the things that Audrey Hepburn probably could do, but was very restricted in their role in the writing of that movie. Just blows mm-hmm. it all out of the water with Grand Vista's iconic intro sweeping around Julie Andrews. Apparently, I saw an interview with her talking about the intro of Sound of Music, and she was like, well, the reason it looks like that, because there's like a sweeping, you know, helicopter shot coming in through the Alps, and that's a quick cut to static, you know, on the ground of her in the face, like a medium shot of her face, right? And the reason they had to do it like that was because she got knocked in her ass every time the helicopter would come around. It was like doing sideways, and so the camera could shoot her, but because it was sideways, the helicopter blades were like blowing in her face, would knock her in the ass every time, so they reset every time they did that. So that was very funny. But yeah, my first time checking out this very iconic movie. Sound of Music, very good. Memorable songs, you know, dynamic moving cameras, very little questionable gender politics, unlike the My Fair Lady. You know, punching Nazis in the face, always great to see. So yeah, Sound of Music, great. Yeah.
All right. I have not seen it since I was in high school, so I probably need to revisit it.
Great, great movie. One more thing before we leave the Best Picture Marathon. My Fair Lady and Sound of Music and a lot of these have intermissions. Do you think, Derek, we should return to the intermission? If your movie is 3 hours long, should we put an intermission in between?
Absolutely. Intermissions need to come back. All right. I have a small bladder, and we need to allow people to get up, stretch their legs, go pee, grab a drink, grab some popcorn, what have you. Yeah. This needs to come back. Movies are too fucking long. I'm so tired of the bullshit Martin Scorsese. Hey, well, you know, sit through my, you know, James Cameron made a fucking movie about water that's 3 hours and 12 minutes and didn't give you a chance to go to the fucking bathroom. So, we need intermissions. Let's get him back, you know.
All right.
I, you know, Ridley Scott, next week I'm covering his director's cut of Kingdom of Heaven. When he took his director's cut on the road, his director's roadshow version, he had an intermission. We can all learn from Ridley, all right?
Yeah. Good. All right. I'll vote for you. I'll sign up for your newsletter. All right. So, leaving Best Picture winner until next time, going to the Movie Swap Challenge. Derek, you assigned me a thing that apparently I had watched an hour and a half of, because I think we talked about this quite a few times already. So, I was an hour and a half into it last time, but I did start it from the beginning. You assigned me the history of the Seattle Mariners. I have notes, I have thoughts. So very interesting, very good documentary. I stopped it a couple times just to be like, okay, a lot of it takes place in late 80s, early 90s, which I was, you know, pretty well steeped into baseball at that point. You know, anybody knows, but especially baseball fans know that the Red Sox were, you know, had the massive drought to 100 or like 86 years, I think it was. So late 90s we had good teams then. I think Red Sox, they mentioned the Red Sox knocking them out in the late 90s of a pennant chase there. So I was very much referencing this and sort of using the context of a lot of what they're talking about to think about, like, what was I watching? Who was in the Red Sox? You know, what did they do? How did they finish compared to the Mariners? But yeah, just talking about overall, very good narrative framework. I thought it was funny that I'm still in the middle of my P&P rewatch. And it's very funny that this, forgot the writer's name of the thing. You had it.
John Boyce.
John Boyce. Thank you. Has a very, like, his narrative framework for this is very similar to the P&P, Big Pete's, talking about how the universe, run afoul of the universe. You run afoul of the natural order of the universe, as they say in this documentary. It was very, very P&P coded, talking about one of the first episodes. I think the first episode of P&P is about Johnny Unitas and how the first letters in Johnny Unitas and the universe are the same, and how television airwaves are set to arrive in Alpha Centauri very, very soon. So I love that their sort of framing of the Mariners' loss is like they ran afoul. They were like, you know, the first stadium burned down, and so they rebuilt it, and it's like, no, that was the universe telling you, Seattle, you should not have a baseball team. But yeah, very good overall. I love that they brought it. I forgot that Randy Johnson was on the Mariners, and I just realized that the big unit is a penis pun of his name. His name is also Randy, and his Randy's Johnson. So that's very funny. Yep, yep. As a kid, I was just like, oh, it's a big unit. Yeah, because he's big. He's a big guy. Oh, that's very funny. They talk about Wade Boggs, again, talking about this, just really relating this whole thing to my upbringing and my dad's love of baseball as well. Wade Boggs was a guy on the Mariners. And I was like, wait, the name sounds familiar. And I remember the name was familiar because my dad apparently had a baseball somewhere in like the attic or the basement. And I was just like playing around there one day. And I go down there and looking around just for like a baseball to use, just to play around with it. And I just grabbed one out of nowhere. Just, I didn't look at it. I just started using it. And my dad comes to the backyard and he's like, hey, look at that. Let me look at that ball. And I handed it to him after they whacked it like 47 times. And he's like, you little shit. And it was a baseball signed by Wade Boggs that's now, you know, useless because all the signature was washed off.
Oh, no. Just like the Sandlots.
Just like the Sandlot. Exactly. So a couple more things. Any questions, comments so far?
I mean, I've talked enough about the history of the Seattle Mariners on this podcast other than to say that, yeah, I'm glad you finally watched it. This is a fantastic documentary, one of my all-time favorites.
One of the questions I had while thinking this, and I want to give it to you, Derek, is do you think it's worse for your home team to be terrible all the time and have no chance of winning ever? Or a team like in the late 90s, like I said, early 2000 Red Sox, who are just barely getting there, just barely getting into it and having a very good team, but just barely getting fucked at the last second. What do you think?
It's interesting because his next couple documentaries really cover this a lot because he does one on the history. His most recent one was the history of the Minnesota Vikings, who are a team that have one of the best winning percentages in the NFL and have never won a Super Bowl. And then also the Atlanta Falcons, and just kind of chronicling, you know, one of the major parts of that obviously is the Super Bowl loss to the Patriots. And I feel like it's as somebody who's been a lifelong Lakers fan, and they've done very well and missed it a few times, and somebody who's been a lifelong Angels and Ducks fan, who they've both been historically bad teams. I think it's easier to just be when you're like, there's just a bad team and you don't get your heart broken.
Yeah.
You know, that's always really rough. I like it when, you know, a team makes it far and, you know, they, you know, like when the Rams made it to the Super Bowl and they lost to the Patriots a couple times, because I'm a big Rams fan too. But it's heartbreaking. It's tough. It's really tough.
I was going to say, oh, you're a Lakers fan, so obviously I would be a Celtics fan if I watched the NBA.
Yeah.
And Bill Simmons was doing an interview with, I forget who it was, not Matt Damon. For some reason, I thought he was interviewing like the Pearl Jam for some reason. I think maybe they were interviewing them. I think maybe they were Lakers fans for some reason. But anyway, he was talking to somebody, and he mentioned Lakers-Celtics rivalry and saying how the Lakers – have to use the record from Minnesota, right? They used to be Minnesota Lakers, right?
Sure.
Sure? Sure what?
I mean, yeah, they were the Minnesota Lakers, but it's still like the same. It's not like I don't know, like, is his the logic argument is that...
Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, yeah. Is the argument that, oh, well, that was so long ago. They were playing in Minnesota. I'm like, well, all of the Celtics championships happened in like the 60s and like 70s when they went on a run. Like the Lakers have a lot more recent success than the Celtics. So Bill Simmons can shut the fuck. Like he's such a fucking homer that he'll just use any excuse to try and like make his Celtics sound good.
Yeah, I think at a certain point, you know, modern, quote unquote, modern sports, right? And the record, modern record keeping has been around for so long, and technology and athleticism and all this stuff has changed so much. I think at a certain point, we're going to be like, all right, anything after like the 30s, it's not, or anything before the 30s, we're not going to count because that was like dead ball era, literally dead ball for baseball. And also, like, yeah, it was all white guys and basketball. So, yeah.
Yeah, if you look at like hockey teams, like, there's like six teams that have way more championships than anyone else in hockey because they were the only six teams in the league until like the 70s or 80s or something, you know? So like there's a reason the Canadiens have so many titles, but, you know, they also haven't won, you know, no team from Canada has won since like, you know, the 1992 or something like that. So yeah. So, you know, it's like the Ship of Theseus thing. It's like, okay, like technically this Lakers team is the same Lakers team, you know, but like by bit and piece, you know, like players, coaches, owners, where they play, like it all slowly gets changed out. So is this Lakers team the same team as the Lakers team from 50 years ago? You know, technically, yes. And that gets even more complicated when you have things like, you know, the New Orleans Pelicans / the Charlotte Hornets, which are both kind of the Charlotte Hornets, but neither of them kind of are. It's a lot.
It is a lot, yeah. And is the Laker team the same Laker team? Is it the same league? You know, it's not the same league was in the 50s and 60s. Mm-hmm. Yeah. A couple more notes I have about the doc. I have a quote here. I'm not sure of the context. Maybe you can help me out with this. Okay. Forever proving the axiom that a person is that I get it. He says, I forget what he was talking about, but he said, forever proving the axiom that a person that's obsessed with TV can never be president. What was he talking about there?
He's making a reference to Trump, obviously.
Yes, but what was the reference in the context of the video?
It was that...
Ken Griffey could never be president.
Yeah, because he had to wake up early to watch TV. And
yes.
It was like a marketing gig that he was like running for president and stuff like that.
Yep. Another connection to the Red Sox, I guess. Apparently, David Ortiz, under a different name, was in the Mariners Farm League, which is funny.
Yep.
One more thing, or a couple more things. Eric Burns, the Eric Burns story, like a Sims character, Burns has also become known for his participation in endurance sports, including triathlons and ultramarathons. I thought that was very funny. A lot of good little stories of, like, you know, you go into this, like, okay, it's just the story of the Mariners, but then it's like, you know, these mini stories within the story of, like, Eric Burns and David Ortiz and all these, like, what ifs and could have beens. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, all these weird, because it's just a collection of all these weird little stories. He does another one also that's really good that you might enjoy called The Bob Emergency, where he just tells the story of, like, Bobs in sports. Like, and it's just like, that's the only thing they have in common is they're all just named Bob. And so, yeah, these, you know, stories where it's like, you know, the humanity on display, these in these great sports stories that, you know, he puts forth, I think are, you know, top notch.
Yeah, they're very good. One more thing. That's what I was going to say. Yes. Okay. So listen, it's a very good doc. I appreciate it very much. Could it have been a podcast, do you think? Do the visuals become necessary at a certain point to tell the story?
Yes, I think so. The graphs that they're using are just so, like, he has this very specific style where he does a lot of, like, you know, they're not, like, they're lo-fi. They're not, like, cheap or chintzy, but they're very, like, lo-fi. And he does, like, a lot of stuff with, like, Google Earth that is really unique. And yeah. I think a lot of people on YouTube have kind of cribbed his style in the intervening years, but I think that having those graphs and just kind of like the visual representations and like figure eight here and like, you know, they're very informative. A lot of times they are a very good punchline for something. So I think absolutely this should be ingested as a documentary.
Yeah, I would agree too. Especially the parts where he's talking about like when Ken Griffey Jr. And also his dad, when they were, you know, taking those massive road trips of just showing how far it actually was. Yeah, that was very funny.
He'll use that to great effect in all of his documentaries.
Yes. So, yeah, glad you assigned it. Glad I finally watched it. Good stuff. Yep. So my assignment to you was Station 11. I think you texted me. Yeah, it's a very Damon Lindelof coded, right?
Yes. Like watching this immediately, you know, brings to mind The Leftovers, obviously, like we mentioned, but also just even beyond the, like, oh, well, it's the end of the world and there's this cult that is like the world should have ended and blah, 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 you know, whatever. There's a lot of like the way that it's structured, you know, with the flashbacks in it, and they'll just have an episode focused on one character and you'll understand why the character is the way they are. That's just all of Damon Lindelof's stuff, you know, Lost, Leftovers, Watchmen, like you know, and it's a style he developed in Lost, but you feel it a lot in this. This is a very fantastic show. I've just been binging it over the past couple days. I'm 6 episodes in of the 10, I believe there are. So I am really digging this, and I think I'll save some of the rest of my thoughts for maybe next week on our what we've been watching. Because I'm not done with it yet, but I really, really dig this. I'm on, I've just finished up episode 6 before we started recording here.
Yeah, okay. Keep my questions to a minimum. So you're episode 6. So you finished 6, is what you're saying, or you're on 6? Or
Yeah, I just finished 6.
Finished 6, okay. Just the first episode was that thing of like, oh boy, coughing. Seeing somebody cough in a theater, you remember that? Remember that feeling? what else am I going to say? Just the whole scene of Jeevan and the kid and Kirsten, right? Him and taking Kirsten to the shopping, to the grocery store, again, evokes early pandemic memories of like, you know, completely nobody's around. The cashier is like, hey, is that because of that thing? Because he's taking like, what, like 7 or 8 carriages with him of food. And the guy
– buys like $9,000 worth of groceries.
Yeah. The cashier is like, hey, should I go? And the guy's like, yeah, you should go.
Yeah.
Just impeccable acting. The score is incredible. The use of score and music. The music drops in the show are great. I discovered a guy named Bill Cavahan. Let me look it up actually, because he had a really great music drop in one of these, and I very much enjoyed his music since then. Discovering it, Bill Callahan is the guy's name. I'm not sure you got to the episode yet, but great music overall, right?
yeah, no, really great score. And like you said, yeah, definitely brings up a lot of COVID memories. You know, there's like a part where two characters have to quarantine and you're just like, oh yeah, okay. And it's, you know, it feels like something that was like, it's like, it basically feels like someone was like, well, what if COVID was worse? You know, because that feels like, yeah, well, all of our worst, like, fears of COVID, like, are this show, you know?
Yeah.
And but it, interestingly, it's based on a book that was written in 2014. Yeah. And then I think, you know, it, you know, came out, like, in, what, 2021? So it's, like, very, like, we were still pretty much in the thick of, you know, we weren't really out of the woods yet in COVID. But I think it's just really interesting the way it comments on, like, you know, you have these characters who were very young when this pandemic happened, when the world changed. And, you know, that almost feels like an analog for, you know, our generation of like September 11th, like you, yeah, people who were born before and weren't after, like people who are like, I was the same age as Kirsten, who, when she goes through the pandemic as when I went through 9/11, you know, and I see a lot of parallels with that and the way that, you know, you grew up in this new world and there's like this, the old world and the people from beforehand. And you see all the people who were born into this new world and they have a totally different perspective than you do, than you who came of age in it. And the people who are older have a different perspective than you who really remember that world a lot better than you do. And then, you know, you have, you know, of course she's not the only character like that. There's another character like that. But yeah. So I think it's really doing some interesting things with all that. I'm curious to see where it goes.
Yes, definitely curious to get your take on the rest of it. All right. So with that, coming to the end here, next week, June 14th, like I said, the big one, Inside Out 2, coming out, directed by Kelsey Mann. Got a stacked cast. We all know them. We know them. We love them. Emotions, teen emotions are going to be coming through here. A couple of different things that I forgot to mention forgot was coming out. A24 movie called Tuesday, Brother Tuesday. Starring Julia Louis-Dreyfus, Lola Pettigrew, and Leah Harvey. Premiered at the 50th Telluride Festival last September. Be released June 7th. There's not much about it. Keeping it very secretive. So I'm assuming there's some sort of weirdness going on here. I think it's like a horror movie or a thriller or something, but I'm definitely excited to check that out. And another one of those like dad movies, they don't get it made anymore. David Duchovny has a movie out directed and written and starring himself with and also Logan Marshall Green, Stephanie Beatrix, and it's called, speaking of the Red Sox, Reverse the Curse. The synopsis is, follows Dave, who moved in with his father, Marty, when he developed a fatal illness. To keep him happy and alive, Ted enlists Marty's grief counselor, Mariana, and friends to fake a Red Sox winning streak. So that's interesting.
Do you remember real fast how lost, like, the Red Sox and the Breaking the Curse played a big role on, like, season two of Lost?
I did not know this. Tell me about this.
So there's a whole thing of like, you know, Jack's dad is like this ultimate pessimist. And, you know, they're both like, he's like a Red Sox fan. And he's like, the Red Sox will never win the series or whatever. And, you know, and that was written, you know, into that, like season one, that's like a thing that happens. And then in between seasons one and two, the Red Sox win the World Series. And they write that into the show where there's a moment where like Jack is like captive, but from the others. And he's like, in the days since you crashed on the island, George Bush has been reelected. This happened. The Red Sox won the series. And then Jack just starts laughing. He's like, you know, if you wanted me to really believe that you had contact with the outside world, you could have chosen some other team than the Red Sox, because they are never going to win, because they are cursed. Like, and it just like, because like, yeah, Kanika believes he's cursed, like never be good enough and never have what it takes. The Red Sox are too. And then Ben just like turns on the TV and it's the moment of them like, and Ben's like, no, you don't get it. They came back. They were down three games of the Yankees. They won four in a row. And Jack's like, yeah, whatever, dude. And he turns it on, and it's just the moment when they win the World Series. And Jack just, like, has this moment where he's like, oh, my God. Like, his world is crashing down around him. It's so good.
That's amazing. And, of course, you know, the other one that was the other piece of media.
Fever Pitch.
Fever Pitch, yes.
Yeah.
That's such a crazy story.
Where they had to reshoot the ending.
Yes. That's amazing. So we got that. That is the last one on June 14th, unless, you know, I think Smaller comes out. And then the week after, June 21st, we got Jeff Nichols, new Jeff Nichols movie. I don't know if we ever talked about Mr. Nichols, Jeff Nichols.
I don't believe so.
First movie was Shotgun Stories, then Take Shelter, which is one of my favorite movies from the 2000s, honestly. Michael Shannon and Jessica Chastain. He did Mud the year after that, did a movie called Midnight Special, which I still need to see, and Loving in the same year. So how familiar are you with Mr. Nichols' filmography?
Okay, I think that's maybe we did talk about him like briefly because Loving was one of my Letterboxd assignments, and that's the only movie I've actually seen.
Gotcha.
But I liked that movie quite a bit.
Yeah, so this should be interesting. Big cast. Jodie Comer, Austin Butler, Tom Hardy, Michael Shannon, Mike Feist, and Norman Reedus. Oh, Carl Glusman. I love that guy. He's like one of these guys, just like pops up in things. They don't have. Do you know who I'm talking about? Carl Glusman?
No.
He was
In Luis Guzman?
No. The guy that was in. He was killed. Oh, sorry. Spoiler alert for Devs. Yeah, Devs. He was killed in Devs.
Oh, that guy. Okay.
That guy. Yeah. Yes.
The guy who they were like trying to like make you think he was the main character in Devs, but it's just like, nope, just kidding. He's dead.
Yeah. And then just out of nowhere, another exorcism film starring Russell Crowe called The Exorcism, directed by Joshua John Miller, who did the 2015 comedy The Final Girls and a USA Network drama series Queen of the South, starring this movie The Exorcism. Which is, I saw a preview for this. I don't know. Do you want me to tell you about this, what this is about?
You can. I'm probably not going to watch it.
It's about people that are making a movie about an exorcism movie.
Okay.
And spooky stuff starts happening on set. stars Russell Crowe, Ryan Simpkins, and Sam Worthington. He's coming back, guys. He's going to be a thing. Wow. couple more things. Janet Planet, a movie I talked about a few times here because it was filmed in Western Massachusetts, directed by Annie Baker, stars Julian Nicholson, Zoe Siegler, and Elias Koteas. So that should be
Casey
cool.
Casey Jones.
Casey freaking Jones. And of course, right. Kinds of Kindness. Every preview I see this is like this. I know less. I know less the more I see this movie. I have no idea what this is going to be about, but it's coming out June 24th. Yes.
Kind of preview as the more you watch it, the less you know. I love it.
Yeah, it's amazing. Emma Stone, Jesse Plemons, Willem Dafoe, Marco Qualley, Hong Chau. Yes, sorry.
Hong Chau. Tom,
yeah, this person.
Are you okay?
Well, it's spelled weirdly, and I wanted to make sure I wasn't mispronouncing Hong Chau. Yeah.
Yeah, Hong Chau. Yeah.
Yes. Joel Alwyn, and Hunter Shaver. A lot of people in this. Can't wait to check it out. One more. Something called Trigger Warning. I was looking up to see what was coming out when this movie popped up. Trigger Warning is an upcoming American action thriller based on a short story by Otep Shemaya, directed by Molly Shuya. So it's an English language debut written by, it's supposed to be, why did I pull this out here? I thought it was like a foreign film. I'm not sure. Oh, a skilled special. So the synopsis of Trigger Warning is a skilled special forces commando, Jessica Alba, takes ownership of a father's bar after he suddenly dies and soon finds herself at odds with a violent gang running rampant in her town. Oh, okay. So that's why I pulled this out, because it was like, you know, action thing Jessica Alba's been in since, like, wasn't she in that that TV show Dark Angel? Yes. From 2000.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Well, she was also in all of the Fantastic Four movies after that.
Yeah. So that is everything coming to the plugs here, plug time. A bunch of podcasts. We did Best of 99, the 10 best movies of the year of our Lord, 1999. Great show. Had fun. A lot of fun doing that. Very fun to listen. Yeah. We got my Medium blog blowing up. Every little post, everything I'm writing about is going on my Medium blog as well. Also signed up for a Substack. So I got that going too. I noticed you were on there as well, so I followed you.
Oh, yeah?
I didn't sign up. You know why I said, do you know why I didn't sign up to that for that up until now?
No.
It just seemed like one of those, like, do you know Quora? What's the Raya. Raya is like the dating app for like celebrities. I thought Substack was like you have to be an established writer to be on there. So that's why I never signed up for it. So yeah, check me out there and on Substack. Look up Damian Sherman. Find me on there. Best of Letterboxd. Letterboxd is Midnight Film Pod. I am 63 away, but drum roll please, 63 away from 1,300 followers still plugging away. What I'm expecting, Derek, what I'm expecting to keep happening or to happen at some point is to reach like this, what do you call that? Exponentially. You know, that's going to exponentially grow. Like I'm going to hit like 2,000 or 3,000 and people are just be like, wow, he has 3,000 followers. I'm just going to start following him. You know, I think at some point I'm just going to reach this magical number where people are just going to start following me en masse. But apparently it hasn't happened yet because I'm basically still getting one follow for every – I'm getting back one follow for every four I do follow people. So not quite happening yet, but hopefully someday.
You'll get there, buddy.
Thanks, man. Film Essayist on YouTube, where you can also check out this podcast, Spotify for Podcasters. Check out all my interviews, Cinematech, B.R. Yeager, Anthony Kaligos, and the interviews me and Dan did talking about Succession Season 4, Bear Season 2. Bears coming out. A lot of shows coming out this month, Derek. I don't know if you saw all the stuff coming out in June, TV-wise. Big month for TV, including The Bear Season 3 coming out on June 27th. Derek, what you got to plug?
So, yeah, check out the Underrated Movie Podcast, where we talk about underrated, underappreciated, under-the-radar films. You know, wrapping up the miniseries that I've been doing for the last 2 months, talking about Extended Editions is the name of the miniseries. And so we look at alternate cuts of films, director's cuts, assembly cuts, what have you. As I said, we're wrapping up with Kingdom of Heaven from Ridley Scott, his director's cut of that. Me and my buddy Karosh had him on and we were talking about that. But there's a whole backlog of episodes to check out of underrated movies. You know, over 130, almost 140 episodes now of movies that we've found underrated. You've been on a couple times.
Yes.
And so, yeah, definitely go check that out. Check out, you know, my stuff at Film Threat, my stuff at Watch Mojo, all over the place. And yeah, I've got a Patreon for underrated, but that about does it.
Nice. Very cool. So for Midnight Film Pod, I've been Damian.
I've been Derek.